Hi, folks. So, it's true. We're all excited about containers. They will not fix a broken tech culture. This entirely not Photoshopped picture I took in Minneapolis, where I live, where it's apparently not just the land of 10,000 lakes, it's also the land of 10,000 DevOps cliches. So we have containers, silos, clouds, the slow-burning tire fire that is Prad right behind my Twitter handle. And I think this also accurately describes so many orgs that people hope to bolt some magical thinking onto. Like, real talk, containers is just a tool. They're one component of a modern platform, something like Cloud Foundry. I mean, I wouldn't want to go back to the before times, but just like there's no DevOps in a box, like there aren't 20 units of DevOps in that shipping container. Like, it's not going to happen. And I'm not just talking like theoretically. Before I joined Pivotal last summer, I was on the ops team at a little streaming video site called DramaFever. It was a lot like Netflix, if Netflix were much smaller and mostly Korean soap opera. And we ran Docker in production in our entire request path starting in October 2013, when the main thing on Docker's website was like, under no circumstances should you run this in production. And we were like, YOLO. But what Cornelia was saying about respecting the differences between us, like, I am on team ops. I know a lot of folks here are on team dev, but I think we can work together. And I can't say for sure that even though we had all of the containers and, you know, microservices and Golang and everything else at that my last job, that we were perfect. Like, we still had that classic wall of confusion that Andrew Clay Schaefer is responsible for, not creating the wall, but, you know, this image. We still had handoff between teams. We still had conflict. Like, as it turns out, I'll let you in on a secret, I found that I was working at a company like run and staffed entirely by humans. Like, chatbots weren't on the payroll. So I remix that wall a little bit and point out the competing incentives between teams. So if you work in an organization where one person is, you know, or one team is celebrating the fact that they shipped some new features, while everyone else is drowning under terrible MTTRs and SLAs, like, you're creating a disincentive to work together. If Team YOLO wants to throw code over the wall and Team Nope is like, I'm going to get paged during my niece's birthday, these people aren't going to like each other very much. And when you get into something like containers or platforms, something that produces a boundary object so that the dependencies that you could worry that Wiley Ops team is going to mess up and your perfect, beautiful code will get shipped and be terrible in production for reasons beyond your control, like, yeah, absolutely. If you're using solutions that contain that a little bit better, it's going to solve a lot of those problems. Containers exist in that liminal space between dev and ops to help with that separation of concerns. Like if you're, you know, shout out to Portland, you know, you got the old airport carpet and the new. It's like, we can, what, you know, just, this works, but, like, watch out if you're throwing shipping containers over that wall. Like, that's going to land on people's heads pretty hard, right? All right, something else to think about. So I'm from the Midwest, and so when people keep going on and on and on about silos in our IT organizations, and I think to myself, like, we overuse this metaphor, I think, a lot in the DevOps community, because something, a couple of things to realize about actual silos. They don't usually exist in isolation. Like, there's usually a few of them, and also, they're pretty dangerous. Like, we talk about the problems with organizational divisions, but I never hear anyone extending the metaphor to how dust is highly combustible. Like, there's a mill that's a museum in Minneapolis right now that exploded in 1878. This poster, by the way, is from World War I, so it's not like we learned. But, like, think about those divisions inside your organization. Like, what does it do to your culture if you deconstruct that monolith, but, all right, now you have microservices and a whole bunch of teams that are in smaller but still warring factions. So, like, humans focus strongly on in-group and out-group, like, who's in their tribe. Microservices are not going to prevent your two pizza teams from needing to have conversations with one another over that pizza. And, by the way, like, how large is that pizza and how hungry are those teams? I feel like there are many unanswered questions about that. So if you have a small cross-functional team, it's a great way to make sure they can all manage to talk to each other, but then all of those teams still need to interoperate to some effect. And this idealized, you know, have everything communicate via APIs, like, that's great. Maybe it's not realistic to start with for every big org, but it's a good plan. you probably still need to talk to one another about things like how you're going to deprecate old endpoints. And like, you know, if you have teams that are communicating via clean APIs, all right, are we not going to have breaking changes in a point release? Like, there are ways to have that still cause problems. And we have this architectural trend towards microservices right now. And one thing I'm going to point out about those is that from an operational standpoint, troubleshooting failure in a distributed system, it requires a lot more visibility into the system. Like, you need to get into distributed tracing. You know, we have sessions later. Adrian Cole will be talking about Zipkin. Like, this is, you need useful windows into your event stream. And like, if you're trying to deconstruct a monolith, you need lots of communication between the teams building the microservices. Where are the boundaries of them? How micro is micro? Like, scoping requires conversation. And also, like, from personal experience, I can tell you that if your health endpoint can't answer unambiguously that everything is 200 OK, you may have scope creep. Like, you have scope creep that that service is not one thing. OK, so like, the cloud, by the way, our last DevOps cliche, I guess it's better than the grid. Like, I'm still holding out for the matrix, because I learned all that matrix multiplication in school, right? That changes plenty, because you're assuming a state, whether it's public whether it's public there's a crowd in front of me. I just want to keep saying it. Public cloud, private cloud, you know, hybrid. You're still talking about, you know, API addressable infrastructure. And also, you're talking about continuous partial failure, like, at all times. Because it's still computers, right? Like, even serverless, which it's still computers. It's still servers. You just can't SSH into them. So. Fortunately, we rarely have to SSH into anything anymore. I got my CS degree right about when Cornelia was getting hers. Like, is this the get off my lawn moment? Like, it was back when the CS department thought it was a good plan to give a bunch of undergraduates root on their faculty members' computers. Like, underfunded CS department, student workers, why not? It was the 90s. Like, many things seemed like a good idea at the time. The tools are definitely improved now, but the principles still remain. So, like, if we go all the way back to the 1960s, Mel Conway could have been talking about today here, right? Like, no amount of orchestrating the scheduling of your containerized microservices is going to make your organization immune to Conway's law. The communication patterns inside your organization are going to dictate the design of your software. Note that I'm not saying the org chart, I'm saying the communication patterns, but if they match each other, you may have problems. It's like, okay, what does this mean? Like, okay, so you get a new platform, maybe Cloud Foundry. You can schedule workloads on it really well. Yeah, does that mean that people are going to run their workloads on that? Like, probably not unless you actually communicate with them. You can't field a dream's your organization's future. And like, I can't predict the future, right? If I could, I should be out in the casino and not on the stage. But so since time goes only in one direction, if we want to look anywhere for clues, it's going to be to the past. And we can find clues in the discussions we've been having in this community for years now. Like, for example, if we look at the sinking of the Vasa, this was a ship that, in the 17th century in Sweden, that it had many issues. And one of them is that the shipwright had all of the plans in his head and died during construction. So, like, if you take one actionable takeaway from this conference, I would say be sure to put the why in your commit messages, not just the what. Because your coworkers and future self are going to be really happy to find out why you committed something that you did. And we talk a lot about speed. At this point in 2009, when Flickr was talking about some stuff they did in 2008, containers obviously existed, but the entire discussion in this part of tech has definitely shifted since then. The cooperation aspect still key. Sobering thought, a lot of orgs still can't ship at this rate, despite it being almost a decade. The better part of a decade and plenty of money. So I'd say the big takeaway there is that tools are important, but they aren't going to solve the problems for you if you can't work with people inside your organization. So finding that place that feels safe, maybe warm, maybe you can absorb a lot of knowledge from stickers. I think that kitten is, by the way, our attack kitten is a lot bigger now, which apparently is what happened when you feed them. And also probably an expert at Docker and Logstash. That's how you get to a place where you can say people over processes over tools. So at Pivotal, like, we hire for empathy. We focus on the people. And we're going to dive deep into a lot of powerful tools this week, as well as the strategies that help our org succeed. So I should tell you, I joined Pivotal to work for my friend Andrew, little idea on Twitter, he's built a lot of this web startup space. He's a founder of the DevOps movement, and he wholeheartedly believes this whole helping others bit from the Agile manifesto. So please welcome Andrew Clay Schaefer.